Come on in, y'all. Come on through. There we go. Hey, Destiny 7, school lady, Prophetess Hannah, I see you. Come on in. My emails didn't come in, so I wasn't able to check the emails and see who all it was that were on. Waiting on my husband to come in. Lady Monique, God bless you. Cat Eye, I see you. Beloved Cheryl, I see you. Come on in, First Lady. God bless you. Hey, Sean. Holy Spirit 26, God bless you. Destiny 7, God bless you. Come on in. This is going to be an interesting class. I was coming one way. Hey, Ebony, God bless you. I was coming one way, and looks like the Lord shifted me just that fast in prayer. He shifted me, I'm telling you. So I'm getting ready to dive in. So we have 12 people. Is it Mike MCCA? God bless you. God bless you. God bless you all. Come on through. I want y'all to come in. Y'all won't be looking at this Holy Bible for a minute. Just for right now, okay? I'm just trying to give everybody time to come on in, okay? Come on in. Come on in. Come on in. Because you see this book right here? We getting ready to go into that. We finna dig in. If you don't, I need you to get pen and paper. Or, you know, this video will be saved for a short time. I will email it to whoever I can email it to, and after that, I'm gonna probably be taking this video down, so this will not be up forever. Tina, hey, God bless you. All right, let's get ready. Okay, come on, check on in, y'all. Come on, come on in, come on in, come on in. All right, let's turn this baby around. Anthony Little, God bless you, Anthony. Cry loud, God bless you. All right, God bless y'all. Bless y'all, bless y'all. Okay, I'm sitting in my dining room area. So I'm going to get situated here in just a second. You may see some activity going on. My son's nurse will be here shortly. She's an overnight nurse, and he gets 7 days a week care from 9 p.m. to 5 a.m. That's a blessing. So if he's screaming in the middle of the night, I ain't got to get out of my bed. I got a nurse in there. Look at God. All right. Bless you, Anthony. Bless you. Woo-wee. Lord have mercy. Come on, y'all. Come on through here. And we're going to talk about this, gatekeepers. Who is ready? Who's ready to hear what the Lord has to say about being a gatekeeper and a watchman tonight? Who's ready? You ain't got to give me hearts. I just want to see who's ready. Who's ready? Okay, Lady Monique, yeah, she said, yeah, yeah. All right now, come on through. Yes, yes, yes. And if you do have your Bible, I sound like the old Baptist preacher. If you have your Bibles, nothing against Baptist preachers, I was Baptist. You do have your Bible. Turn with me in your Bibles. To Galatians chapter 5. Uh-oh. Galatians 5. Come on. I'm waiting on you. Trust me. Y'all worth waiting on. If you do not know where Galatians is, you don't know where it is, I'm going to help you real quick. Okay, we're going to do a little Bible lesson. It's going to be right after 2 Corinthians. Somebody may be watching. Who knows? Okay, and they don't know. And after 2 Corinthians, you should find Galatians. And you will see these four categories or these four books behind Galatians. Okay? I mean, not Galatians, but 2 Corinthians. And guess what it's called? General Electric Power Company. Okay? Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians, General Electric Power Company. You may not pop that tonight. Go in your room, son. Go away. Out of my sight. Out of my sight. Okay. All right. Did y'all get that? General Electric Power Company. All right. Okay. I'm going to take care of you, baby. I got you. Mama know you're hungry. You stay hungry. That's why I can't wait for school to start back. Yeah. Okay, so we're going to start with Galatians chapter 5, starting at the 19th verse. And we're going to read to the 21st verse, okay? Now, after I read that God's tornado, I like that name. After we read that, I'm going to explain to you what a gatekeeper is. I'm going to explain to you what a watchman is, what an intercessor is. Tonight is going to be almost like a nutshell, but the Lord has specifically instructed me on certain things, okay, about walking in any one of those areas of ministry. And there's some things that we have got to get together in the body of Christ before we can fulfill those shoes, all right? Okay, so there's my man. Hey, sweetheart. Hey, all right? Now we're going to read, and we're going to start at the 19th verse, okay? Mm-hmm. Hey, Rod! How you doing? Okay. Y'all ready? But if you, it says, let me make sure this is right. Nope, I'm in 15. 15. So I don't want to start there. Well, do I want to start right there? Yeah, let me start at 15. That is God. Let's start at 15. I did not know that was there. But if you bite and devour another. Try to make me blush. If you bite and devour another, watch out that you are not consumed by one another. But I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the desires or the lust of the flesh are against the Spirit. Y'all do that. I know y'all know that. And the desires of the Spirit are against the flesh. For these are opposed to one another. You can't be a spiritual being and say that you in the Spirit and you are of the Spirit of God and you're always in your flesh. Something ain't right. You can't shake and bake with that. And then it says to keep you from doing things that you want to do. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. Uh-oh. Now, the works of the flesh are evident. I'm reading from a different translation. Sexual immorality. Impurity. Sensuality. Idolatry. Sorcery. Enmity. Strife. Jealousy. Fits of anger. Rivalries. Dissensions. Divisions, envy. You see that a lot in the body of Christ, huh? Mm-hmm. Drunkenness. Orgies. And things like these. I warned you as I've warned you before. So that means that Apostle had to keep coming back to them with the same old stuff. That those who do such things, they will not inherit the kingdom of God. Then it says, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness. We lacking a lot of that. Goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things, there is no law. I think I'm going to keep reading. And those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified or have killed or have mortified the deeds of the flesh. Right here it says, and those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and its desires. For if we live by the Spirit, let us also keep in step with the Spirit. We got to move when he move. We got to go when he go. We got to sit when he say sit. Let us not become conceited. I see a lot of that, especially here on Periscope. Provoking one another, envying one another. And that's the end of chapter 5 of Galatians. Now I'm going to go into this, okay? So I'm probably going to receive testimony and reports from people that ShaRhonda is mean after this class. What I want to explain to you, I'm going to go through the list again. And guess what I did for you all? I gave you definition to each list, and I'm going to break it down, and I'm going to show it to you how we see it in the body of Christ, and how the people are entangled with the yoke of bondage, and how the people are operating out of the lust of flesh. Not everybody. It's not everybody, but I guarantee you everybody, including myself, can find yourself somewhere in this. You want to know why? Because you have not yet come into the fullness of perfection yet. And if you want to be a gatekeeper, if you are a gatekeeper, a watchman, an intercessor, a warrior, saved, if you are an apostle, especially to the fivefold officers, if you are operating in a fivefold office, meaning if they call you apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, teacher, guess what, sweetheart? You need to glue your ears to this Periscope, because what's about to happen is we're about to see the judgment of God come in like never before. And the judgment, it starts where? It's going to start at the house of God first. It's going to come right in the house of God. See, we so busy as saints, we looking at people, you a homosexual. And I know I'm anointed. Baby, what you say don't move me, because I am anointed and I know God and I have a relationship with God. Therefore, I am pure and you are impure. God looking at you. Because the scripture says, with love and kindness have I drawn you. Either they get you or they're not going to get you. They're going to love you or they're going to hate you. The scripture didn't tell you to sass nobody. The Bible never told you to treat someone as if you are over them and they are beneath you. Because when it's all said and done, there is one God. The Bible says that there is one God, there is one faith, and there is one baptism. How dare you, as a fivefold officer, put your nose over anybody that is living in sin, that is enjoying the lifestyle of sin. We are to reach out. We should, every last one of us, if you are on this scope and you are saved, you should know how to evangelize. Screw your itineraries. Screw how many engagements you have in your pulpit. Can you go into the mailbox or go into, what is it, UPS? Can you go into UPS and minister to the Satanists that's standing behind you in line? Do you know how to keep your middle finger connected with the rest of your four fingers that is on your hand when you are in traffic? Do you know how to do that? Can you not get upset with people when they have done everything in their spirit and in their flesh and in their natural self to get up under your skin? Can you keep it together? Can you do that? Because all of those things are set for distractions to get you off course. And this is why, as gatekeepers, watchmen, and intercessors, we have got to understand that we cannot be in operation of the works of the flesh. Now, I'm going to go into what a gatekeeper, I left my notebook. I'm going to have to just go from the top of my spirit, and we're going to reiterate this next week. So I'm just going to have to flow from what I know, because I left my notebook, Lord. I got two notebooks, actually three notebooks with all my notes in it, and I only brought one, but that's okay. We're going to flow from there. But I'm going to tell you just from without, you know, of my spirit, what a gatekeeper is, what a watchman is, and what an intercessor is. Tonight, when I get those notebooks, if you want scriptures, if you want information on that, trust me, hit me up in my email. I'm going to give you all the scriptures that you need so that you can have something to study. I want you to read behind me. I want you to check the sources. Everything that I'm telling you, don't just take it for word because you trust me and you trust my husband's ministry. Don't do that. Because guess what? along with the works of the flesh, we're going to find that in there. I'm telling you. So, with that being said, let's talk about the gatekeeper. Now, let's take us back into biblical times. We're going to go all the way back in the BC, all right, before Christ. Let's go all the way back. Let's say 933 BC. Let's take it back. And we have castles. Let's say we're in a castle. All right, let's say I'm the queen of the castle and my husband's the king of the castle. Now, outside of that, you have walls. If you can envision a castle, they have towers and things like that, and those are classified as walls. All right, each wall has a gate. There is several gates to a territory or to a kingdom. Now, this is just in the natural. So just imagine how it is in the realm of the spirit, okay? So as you see this in the natural, I want you to translate this over into the things of the spirit. Now, in the main entrance, on the ground level, there are gatekeepers, all right? Now, you can be... Can I say the word, Lord? Okay. All right. You can't be a punk and be a gatekeeper. And I don't mean by sexuality. I'm talking about you can't be scared being a gatekeeper. Because the gatekeeper will have more access to the people via the watchman. The watchman is positioned on the wall. The job of the gatekeeper is to make sure that everything that goes in the place or in a city or in a building that they can get in if they were permitted to go in, and make sure that whatever stays in supposed to stay in, what goes out, they are in control of what comes in and what goes out of that city, of that kingdom, of that castle, of that territory, atmosphere, whatever you want to call it. Okay, that's the job of a gatekeeper. Now, the job of a watchman, they stand on the wall and they are to watch. If I or my husband, as a king or queen, go to the watchman and say, I need you to stay watch all night long, you can't kick your legs up and sit down on your watch and take a power nap. You cannot do that. And what we're seeing in the body of Christ, it is so many people that are operating in a fivefold office. They are asleep on God. Even Jesus had watchmen. And he didn't have his own synagogue. He didn't have his own church building. Okay? But he did have apostles. Now, even Jesus had his own watchmen, because he had two of his apostles. And when he went to go pray, he had set aside two of his apostles, because he knew that, number one, his time was near. He knew that. Now, so that they could not get him before his time, they were to be on watch. But what were they doing? What did the Bible say? The Bible say that they were found asleep, and he came to them and he rebuked them. He said, you can't even watch for 2 hours. We have people, I'm talking about, they makeup is fried, dilated to the side, baby. That wig is in place. That wig is shift right. But when I tell you, they can't pray past 5 minutes. You've been asleep on your assignment. If you can't pray effectively for 5 minutes straight, there is a problem. When I set the standard so low right there, the bar has been dropped like low down low. If you can't pray through for 1 hour, you've been asleep on your assignment. If you can't pray through for 2 hours, you've been asleep on your assignment. You're not a watchman. You can enroll to be a watchman. I'm not talking about this class. I'm talking about in the realm of the spirit. You need to start all over. And the reason why is because at some point in your walk with Christ, you were contaminated by one of the such, which would be connected to the works of the flesh. You get it? So My husband said he about to run. So, if you have not been on your assignment, something has created a portal in your atmosphere. Something has. And has gained access into your spirit, into your territory. When it's dealing with your soul, you are to be guarding your eye gate. We talked about this last night. You have to guard your eye gate. You have to guard your ear gate. You got to guard your mouth. You got to guard everything about you as much as you can do so in the spirit. How do I guard, Prophetess? How do I do it? By praying in the spirit. You have got to have a personal prayer life. I talked about this in my intercession class, dealing with intercession. You have prayer, which I call basic prayer, and it's really nothing basic about prayer. You have your basic prayer, then you have intercession, and then you have prophetic intercession. Basic prayer is what a lot of us lack. Because we're so busy trying to jump into prophetic intercession, we forget about regular intercession and basic prayer. Meaning, basic prayer, here's the difference. Basic prayer, Father, I just give you glory. I thank you, God. Father, we just thank you for this day. Father, I just love you. I worship you. I adore you. In your personal time now, in your personal time, when you're in the car, when you're using the bathroom because you ate about 5 burritos and you stuck on the toilet. Now, I know that's disgusting, but I'm just saying. You know, when you're in your closet trying to find something to wear, basic prayer. Can I pick this out? Basic prayer. Consulting God in everything you do because you understand that the scripture says that the steps of a righteous man are ordered by the Lord because you know that he is a light. Until a lamp unto your feet and a light unto your path, because you understand that scripture, because you understand that God is the keeper and he is the watchman and the lover of your soul. But he can't do that for everybody because we have not let him in. Now, the funny thing about it is, if the gatekeeper is not careful and just let anybody in, they can get to anybody in their kingdom, including the watchman. You are the watchman of your soul. But the Lord is to be, you are the gatekeeper of the soul. You are the watchman. And God is supposed to be able to come in, but we won't let him in. The scripture says that Yeshua said, "Behold, I stand at the door and I knock." And while we shooting, just dancing, and hop, hop, shut, cop, pop, ta da 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 da, and we doing all this bucking, he's standing outside and he knocking. We look like the Laodicean church, pretty much. We want to have prayer revivals. We got deliverance services. We got, you know, money coming to the show and money coming through the door revivals. And we having conferences. We have seminars. We have all these different things. And nobody, not anymore, I'm sorry, and I hate to say that, but nobody that I know that I've come in contact with is literally being taught true holiness. What is holiness? Meaning to be set apart. But we so busy trying to be connected to everything. We want to be attached to everything because, honey, you know, you can't be too holy. You got to be able to get it in and you got to go in. You got to be able to mingle. I don't want to mingle because I'm not of this world. The Bible said that we are not of this world. We're supposed to be transformed by the renewing of our mind. About to knock my bow right out of my head, trying to keep my hair out of my eyes, y'all. So, I want to talk about the works of the flesh. Before I get into that, thank you, Lord. I have to finish the different types of prayer. Now, you have basic prayer. I told you that. That's worship. That's adoration. That's admiration to the Lord. This is your basic communication to the Lord. It's just like I'm coming to my husband. I talk to my husband every single day. I cannot. I don't care how mad I get at him. I do not know how to not talk to my husband. Even when I tell him, you know what? I'm giving you the silent treatment. And I still got something to say. I still got to talk because that's my husband. We have a real relationship. Understand that? So now it's the same way with the Lord. What I don't understand, we talk to our armor bearers more than we talk to God. We talk to our spouses more than we talk to God. We cussing our kids out. We talking to our children. We talk to the dog more than we talk to God. Some of us got parakeets. We talking to the parakeet trying to make a dumb bird talk. And we talk to a parakeet more than we talk to God. Shouldn't be. And you don't understand now, why is it that God is vexed? The scripture talks about, and I'm just throwing out every scripture that I did not write down in my notes. None of these scriptures are in my notes. But the scripture talks about how there arose a generation who knew not the Lord. We are looking at that generation right now, even the generation that we are seeing in the church. You got pastors fighting against pastors, apostles attacking apostles, prophets attacking prophets, evangelists trying to outpreach another evangelist. We trying to cast the devil out better than another person casting out the devil. What has become the problem with the church? It's the work of the flesh, and we are so blind we can't see it. Because why? We have skipped the process of basic prayer, and we don't want that. Because as soon as we come to God and we try to worship, God is going to turn our hands around and say, look at them hands. You got dirty hands, baby. You can't come and talk to me right now. Wash your heart. You need to wash your mouth. Wash your step. Purify yourself before you approach yourself to a holy God. So now, what do we do? So what do? We skip past prayer. We don't want to worship. Oh, we'll praise in a minute. Baby, let me tell you something. A monkey can jump up and down to a beat of a drum. An elephant know how to stomp. You don't believe me? Go to the circus. Ringling Brothers be all over the United States. And watch them play the drums and watch the animals dance. They can make a dog dance. A mutt can dance. A stripper can dance. A person who's, you know, go to dancing school and hip hop and all of that, they can dance. Anybody can dance. You don't have to be possessed with the Spirit of God to dance. Anybody can dance. However, but those who worship Him, it's two requirements. You have to worship Him what? In spirit. And you have to worship Him in truth. But you cannot worship Him when you are operating, and I'll have to show it to you, when you are operating in the lust of the flesh. You can't worship a holy God when you dirty and you nasty. You have to wash. See, that makes me want to go into the teaching of the tabernacle. We don't want to die, so we jump past the brazen altar. We just waltzing in the gate. We got saints coming in. They jumping past the brazen altar. Forget the brazen lavender. I ain't washing. I'm clean enough. You can't see I'm clean. I'm anointed. God called me to be an apostle. Baby, bye. We go right into the inner courts. We don't want no word, because if it ain't cutting us, if it's cutting us, we upset. If it ain't shouting us, we upset. So we going past the table of the showbread. We don't want no anointing, because we feel like we've already been anointed, because God taught me Himself. So we going past the table of incense. We don't want the light of God. So we going past the candle stand. We going past the menorah. And we want to go straightway to the Ark of the Covenant. And you are asking, you are begging God for somebody to have them chains that's wrapped around your ratchet ankles and snatch you out that temple dead, because that's what's going to happen. And you wonder why you can't cast out the devil. You speak in tongues real good, baby. Your tongues sound fleek. But your tongues can't scare Satan. You know how to lay hands and make a person fall out. Emotionalism. Emotions. Honey, R. Kelly can get on a platform and sing. If he's singing the right tune, somebody willing to drop their underwear now and they'll throw it on the stage. Emotionalism. It's the same way. John P. Key can get up there and he can hit the right note, and before you know it, somebody break out and shouting. Musicians know how to play. It doesn't take nothing to move. But it takes a crucified flesh. And it takes a person who is completely 100% alive in the spirit to move God. And you wonder why some of us, we come into the sanctuary and they say, I don't see how you can sit on that step like a knot on a log, or how you can sit there, do praise and worship. And we see, you got the praise, and you looking like I'm vexed. And I don't know why I'm vexed. I mean, I love y'all. I'm vexed. Why? Because nobody is into basic prayer anymore. You want to know why? Because basic prayer turns their mirror on yourself. Michael Jackson said it best. I'm looking at the man in the mirror. I'm asking him to change his ways. Now, if Michael Jackson, who was a Jehovah's Witness, had enough sense to say, I need to check myself out. Before I can judge you, before I can talk about your stuff, I need to deal with mine. Because guess what? Basic prayer gonna really tell you about yourself. You can talk about somebody's hair being nappy. Ooh, they hair nappy. But then when you pull your wig off, you bald headed. I guarantee you, Prophetess ain't bald headed up under here. I can tell you that right now. You can see my pictures and know that. But that's a joke, but I'm just saying. Somebody laugh. But I'm telling you, that's what we do. We talk about people's house, and our house is nasty. Oh, you just see my living room and my kitchen and my dining room area. You ain't seen my bedroom. You ain't seen my closet. You're not permitted to come back there because I'm trying to look good for you. But in actuality, you want to know the lifestyle of a person? Check them bedrooms out. Check them closets out. Ouch, somebody. I can say it. Well, I can't say it now because my house is spick and span. Babe, I don't play about that. My husband will tell you that. I'll get up at 4 and 5 o'clock in the morning and start cleaning. I don't play about that. We got preachers who have wives. We have preachers who have husbands, and they do not take care of home. I could tell you right now, I know some people right now who are married and are preaching the gospel. I am sorry, Miss Ma'am. You cannot be my spiritual covering and be my spiritual mother if your husband can come home from work and he hungry as a dog and you ain't cooked nothing. You need to check your flesh. We got silly women in the church, laden with lust. Oh, Bishop, I fixed you a plate. Apostle, I cooked you something. But your husband and your children hungry. Your husband ain't ate, your kids nappy headed, got snot going down their face, and you got MAC makeup, your roller set is tight and right. We gotta check ourselves. You gotta check yourself. Gotta check yourself. You'll never see me. You'll see me looking crazy, but you'll never see my kids looking all crazy. Not in public you won't. Oh, no, you won't. Oh, no. Because why? The Bible even says, I don't even know why I'm this way. But the Bible says that a wise woman does what? She builds her house. I don't care what you say. You can look like you holy. You can act like you holy. You can smell like you holy. But baby, holiness will really show up when it's time to check your power. I have an S7. A Galaxy S7 phone. People look, oh girl, your phone. Oh, you got the gold one too? Oh girl, that phone bad. But it ain't gonna serve you no purpose if it ain't got no power. Just a pretty phone. Nice case. Bling case. But no power. You wanna know why? Because it has not been connected to the source. All right, basic prayer. We talked about that.
intercession, having the ability to pray for another. Basic intercession says, Anthony, I want to pray for you. Or Anthony says, hey, can you pray for me, sis? Because I need this and I need that. You know, that bill, I got to pay it. And I just don't know how I'm going to get it done. It's going to have to take the hand of God. Basic intercession says, still talking about gatekeepers, watchmen, and intercessors. Remember intercessors? Okay. It's part of the class. Basic intercession says, okay, Anthony, of course, I'll be praying for you. I got your back. I'm going to cover you in prayer. Father, in the name of Jesus, you see the needs that Anthony has. Cover him, God. It's kind of like a Joel Osteen prayer. Nothing wrong with Joel Osteen, but I'm just saying, you know. Father, touch his finances, God. Make sure he has more than enough. God, in the name of Jesus, supply him with all of your needs according to his riches and glory. In Christ Jesus' name, it is so. Because you said where there are two or three who are gathered in your name and stand in the midst, you'll be right there. And God, we just believe. We just believe that you're going to do it. But guess what? He ended up paying the bill, but he may have paid it late. Because how you delivered the prayer, we're lazy in intercession. God waking you up 3 and 4 and 5 o'clock in the morning. Some of y'all know y'all don't even drink water before y'all go to bed. Y'all know y'all don't drink water. You know you ain't had nothing to drink. But all of a sudden, your bladder just going crazy. Why? You're not diabetic. So why do you have to use the bathroom so bad? Because God's trying to wake you up. God's trying to call you. For some of you, he don't wake you up that way. For some of you, you know good and well you didn't set no alarm clock, but somehow your alarm clock is going off and you looking like, I did not set this clock. Why is it going off? Some of you, you just wake up out of a dream, just out of nowhere, and you see the times like 333. That's a call. Y'all remember when we used to have the pagers? And we used to put 911. That means call me right now. It's an emergency. It doesn't mean dial 911. It doesn't mean that. It says, when you saw 911 in your page, it's important. I need to talk to you right now. That's why when some of you wake up at 3:33 in the morning, 4:44, you know, 3:21, times like that, you know the numbers are prophetic. God's calling you. God's calling you. He's telling you, come to me. I got something to tell you. I got to tell you something. This is what basic prayer and intercession does. You can't just operate out of basic prayer and not some at some point in your life flow in intercession or have the ability to intercede. The ability to intercede is almost like the job of a lawyer. God being the judge, you, the intercessor, is the lawyer. I love this analogy. And whoever you're praying for, case in point, I'm the intercessor, God's the judge, but Anthony, he is the plaintiff. Or he's the defendant. In most cases, it's defendants. But I'm not going to say defendant. You know, I'm going to say plaintiff for Anthony's sake. Okay? Because I don't know him like that. But for most of us, we're really the defendant. Because we see somebody in sin and we like, oh, God, you can really kill him in this mess, but don't let him die. Yes, Lord. And so what the lawyer does is, they have the ability because, see, the lawyer know the law. They know the law in and out. They know what the law say. They know how to get around the law. They know the judges. I'm going to tell you something. I've been to court and I've had lawyers and they told me, oh, you be all right with this lawyer, with this judge right here. This judge right here, they're going to show you a little mercy. Yeah, they ain't going to get you for that traffic ticket right there, so don't even worry about that. You get what I'm saying? They know the judges. They have a relationship with them. Lawyers do. So what does that say? That means that as an intercessor, I know the judge. I know what makes him mad. I know if he gonna be nice. I know if he gonna be lean. I know what he play about. I know what he don't play about. I know what makes him tick. I know what's gonna make him say, oh, you know what? I'm gonna show you some mercy. And so what intercession does is just like what a lawyer does in a courtroom. See, we play when we say, well, Jesus was a lawyer in the courtroom. Yeah, I bet he was. Because some of us were not fit to go to God. So we had to have someone who was worthy to approach a righteous judge on our behalf. So what they do is they go to the judge and they tell the judge, okay, I know they messed up. I know that they deserve life in prison. I know that they didn't make this payment on time. But judge, I know the law. And the law also say X, Y, and Z. Can you please grant mercy? Now, here's the problem. You can't be no lawyer in no courtroom, baby. And you trying to cover somebody who's a dope dealer. And you buying from them. Because the judge gonna know that about you. And the judge gonna say, you know, but how you gonna defend a dope dealer and you a dope dealer yourself? I don't trust none of y'all. That'll make the judgment not only bad on your part, that'll get you kicked out of the courtroom. And not only that, that will make the judgment for the defendant or the plaintiff even worse. So let's turn this around in the realm of the spirit. Hey, baby. Let's turn this thing around in the realm of the spirit. In the realm of the spirit, you can't be my intercessor if I got a problem with cussing and you cussing out bishop. Now, I be cussing my dog out all the time. But if you cussing your bishop out, you cussing your husband out and stuff like that, you can't intercede for me because you weak in that same area I need help in. All of us gonna be in a ditch. Y'all, come on now. Come on. So what's going to happen? So what do we need as an intercessor? Somebody that's purified. Somebody who knows the law. Somebody who understands how God, he lives. We know how he ticks. We know what makes him mad. We know what makes him happy. We know what we need to do. Sometimes it takes the lawyer saying, hey, I can get you past this, but you got to make them payments on time. Okay, I can get the judge to like you, but if you ain't doing your part. So that means even as an intercessor, I have the right to tell you I can pray for you. But baby, if you don't stop smoking the crack, I can pray for you. But if you don't learn to shut your mouth, I can pray for you. But if you don't get up off your back and stop screwing, it ain't much of anything that I can really do for you. I can bring you before God. I can pray for you. But that's where the book stops at, right there. That's it. But a prophetic intercessor, and this is my favorite. I ain't got to know your name. I don't have to know your business. I can be in La La Land, and God will interrupt my dream with one of y'all nappy-headed saints watching this little broadcast. Don't worry, my hair napping too. It is. I promise. This wig even napping, so don't feel bad. All I know is I could be dreaming about ice cream cones and cherries. And all of a sudden, God bring Rashania up in my dream. And in my dream, she fighting demons. I can wake up out of that dream and call her in the middle of the night. And if she answer that phone, I saw in the realm of the spirit, woman of God, you was fighting, you was doing this, and the Lord told me that you was fighting against the spirit of rage, or you was fighting against the spirit of hurt or anger or whatever, you know, I'm just naming some stuff. And the Lord told me to tell you, and God said this, and then I can pray without you even telling me one word, but the situation is accurate. A prophetic intercessor. Now, what the church like to do, we want to jump into prophetic intercession. But we ain't prayed. We ain't interceded, not even on our own behalf. We prayed, but we ain't pray for our husband. We ain't pray for our kids. We ain't pray for our wives. We ain't pray for our mammy. We ain't pray for our pappy. We ain't pray for nobody. But we want to go straightway in the church house and start prophesying. Even false prophets have an accurate word. See, that's why you can never come to me and prophesy a word to me and think you're going to move me. Because that's not what moves me. If it don't move God, why am I moved by accurate prophecy? Well, I knew God was going to edify me. I knew God was going to raise us up, or, you know, he was going to set us down in another area. I knew that. But my concern for you is your soul right with God? Yes, by all means, give me the word. God telling you to tell me something. My husband said something in class Saturday. It was so good. He said, I can use a donkey to talk. He can use a donkey to minister to anything and say whatever. God can use a child. God can use a street sign. God can use stores. He can use traffic lights. He can use a train. He can use anything to give you a sign. God can use what he wants to use. But he does it for those that he loves. Meaning, I don't want to be used by God. I mean, I want God to use me, but I want him to love me and use me. Do you get what I'm saying? I don't want to just be used by God. There was a powerful preacher. I'm not stating the name. And this was the example that my husband used. And I saw it. I saw the video myself. And this man of God said it. And he said, God, I'm high. I've been smoking crack. And I'm talking about I'm going out here and I'm high as a kite. But when I lay hands on these people and cast the devil out, the devils are coming out. People are getting delivered. People are getting set free. But I ain't set free. I'm a mess. And he said, you want to know why, son? He said, because I'm using you because I love them. And the worst feeling that you can ever get from anybody that's in a relationship is if you find out that you were in a relationship with somebody and they was only in it for the money, or they was only in it for because they saw that you was capable and you was a willing vessel. You being a willing vessel ain't gonna get you into the kingdom of God. No, it's not gonna get you in the kingdom of heaven. Because you did real good because you preached at 30 cities. No, baby. No, that ain't gonna get you in. Now, let's go ahead on into the works of the flesh. Now, I'm going to read the list just like I said I would. I'm going to read the list of what I have in my notes because it does read a little bit different versus what I have here in the Bible, okay? Yes, you got to have the relationship. Baby, we can't drop no mics. All right. So, we have adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance. Okay, let's see. Emulation. I can't wait to get to that one. Wrath. Strife. Seditions. Heresies. Envying. Murders. Drunkenness. Revel. And that's what I have. Let's start with the first one. The first one is adultery. Now, before I go into all of that, I want you to understand again why I'm going through the works of the flesh, because we don't read that a lot. We don't want to see that. We want to skip to Jeremiah chapter 1. We want to go straight to Jeremiah 1. And we want to see how God created us and he called us from the mother of our, from the womb of our mamas and all of that, because, you know, we want to hear how we was ordained to be a prophet before the foundation of this world and how we were just all caught up in the heavenly realm. We want to hear that kind of stuff, but we don't want to be clean. We don't want to be right. So we got to go through this, okay? Because if you're going to be an effective gatekeeper, a watchman, or an intercessor, you have got to go through this. You have got to make sure that you are in check, because you don't want God to just use you and use you. And when it's time to be called up to be with the Lord, you're left behind. You don't want that. You don't want that. I know I don't want it. So I want God to clean me. I want him to make me right. I want to be holy. Holiness is a dirty word now. Y'all notice that? As a matter of fact, I'm finna check you. I'm finna check some of y'all right now. When I say check you, I'm not talking about like put you in check. I ain't talking about like that. I'm gonna ask you a question and we finna do a little roll call real quick. I want you to comment the last time Prophetess Tayana does not count, because I know she getting the word, because I'm jealous of her. I ain't lying. She right over there with our spiritual covering and he teaching holiness. I got to say that, so you can't count in this questionnaire right here. When was the last time
or yet you can. You can come in on this, that you visited another church or a church in general. Doesn't have to be your church or whatever. When was the last time that you went into a service and you heard a really good, wholesome word on pure and true holiness? I want somebody to put it up. I want you to comment. I guarantee you somebody's going to say probably about a good 5 years. When was the last time, especially if you live here in Memphis, Tennessee, somebody said Sunday, Lola, I need to come where you at. 3 years ago. It's been years. I was a kid. Wow. Long time. Been a while. 2 years ago, Caleb said. In Florida. I don't get it in Memphis at all. And I'm going to tell you what we get rebuked about in Memphis. We get rebuked in Memphis, about who we are. Well, if you're this and if you're acting like that, you don't need a microphone. Screw a microphone. I don't want a microphone. I'm trying to get into the kingdom. I want to please God. I'm not trying to please you. I'm not rushing to a microphone. This phone is my microphone. Can y'all hear me? Y'all can hear me? Okay, good. You can hear me. That's my microphone. No tea, no shade, no none of that. But we get that a lot. I'm talking about a lot of these mega ministries. We get that all the time. And the reason why, and in a way I can't blame them, I'm going to tell you why. Because people are so hungry to run to a platform before their time, and they have baked. They have not been processed. They have not gone through what the necessary things that they needed to go through. We always trying to rush out before our time. And we're messed up. Wow. I was able to actually look down and read some of the comments. Okay. The last time I heard in Memphis a good word on holiness. I would probably waste a lot of your time trying to honestly think about it. Here's the last question. When was the last time you heard the word preached on holiness from someone that you know by way of discernment that the person was living right? Because we have some of those too. You preach on holiness, but you're not doing it. When was the last time you said, I know this person is, they may not be perfect, but they are living holy? 3 years ago. Yeah, baby, if some folk be lying, they be lying right through their teeth. I'm going to tell you something. You don't have a heaven or hell to put me in. I ain't got to lie to you. I'm going to tell you just like a T.I. is. My husband tell you in a minute, I don't take no tea for the fever. For what? Why am I going to do it? I'm going to tell you the whole truth. Yeah, I skipped out. I didn't come to church because I didn't want to come. I was in the bed. I was at Bedside Baptist. That's why I didn't come to church. Okay. That's sad. The responses that I'm getting that say, see, 2 years ago in Jackson with Prophet Queets, that's my covering. That's my covering right there. That's how I know. I know that man teaching holiness, and he's casting devils out on a regular basis, taking people to deliverance on a regular basis because of intimate relationship. That's it. Shall we? Let's go into the works of the flesh. I promise you there's some butter. There's some good old sweet honey butter coming behind this with the fruit of the Spirit. The works of the flesh, let's start with adultery. The definition of adultery. Y'all ready for this? Because some of this is going to get real raw. I'm going to tell you right now. So if you got children that's listening, you might want to get them some headphones to go play on their Xbox or something. Okay? Now, adultery, voluntary sexual intercourse with someone that you are not in covenant with when you are already in a covenant. Let me break that down. When you having sex with somebody and you married, but you having sex with a person you ain't married to. That's adultery. We see that all the time in the church, right? Now, let's flip that coin on the spiritual sense. Let's flip it on the spiritual side. The Greek word for adultery is called moesho. Okay? Moesho. Do not ask me how to spell it. I just know how to pronounce it. I will find it. Baby, see if you can spell Moe Show, because we talked on this before. Okay. And I think it's M-O-I-C-H-O or something like that. Now, what basically Moe Show is when you leave out of covenant with the Holy God to entertain something else. That's adultery. Spiritual adultery. This is the work of the flesh. Works of the flesh. When you are in a relationship, you being the bride of Christ, you spending more time and you have more of your intimacy in television than you do in the presence of God. Adultery. When you spend more time crossing out crossword puzzles than you do reading the word. Adultery. Works of the flesh. Things that will block you from being an intercessor, a gatekeeper, a watchman. These are things that will cause you to be asleep on your wall. Fornication does not involve a marriage, but yet you are sexually active. Let's flip that in a spiritual kind of sense. You have no relationship with God, none whatsoever. You don't even have a relationship with people, but you got a relationship with your ministries. You got a relationship with itinerary speaking. For your booking information, contact me in my email. Email me at call my admin. But you have not prayed since God knows when. Like for real prayed. You don't live a consecrated life. Because the most of the consecration we see is you on Periscope. If I see a Periscope of you every day for longer than an hour, every day, 2-3 hours a day, and you doing multiple Periscopes and you a prophet, and then when you off of Periscope, you on Facebook, and you constantly rolling up with all these different statuses. The statuses sound good, but where your prayer life? Where's your time with God? I know some apostles right now who had porn all down their page, and it would always start at 3 and 4 o'clock in the morning, and they had no idea that the porn was being posted on their page. And I'm not talking about a hacker, because you can find them and you can look them up and people know them. Especially when you're interacting with them. I tell you, Facebook know how to expose you. Facebook know how to do it real good. I'm telling you now. Because you do know your Gmail and your emails and stuff like this all linked to Facebook. And there are times, because they do have access to you, there are times where you can post something you ain't got no business posting. And at any given moment, I've seen it happen. I'm telling you what I know. At any given moment, the government or whoever, the admins of Facebook can take your stuff and just expose you just like that. I've seen it happen. I have. Okay, fornication. Uncleanness, check this out. Morally or spiritually impure. You live right, you fast 7 days a week for 3 hours a day, every single day. You don't skip a beat, you're fasting. You even praying. You know you praying, sound like you praying with power, but the people still leaving the same way they came. Because there's somewhere in your life where you are not clean. Even in your emotions. You holy in your walk, in your natural walk, but in your mind, what's in that mind of yours? What's going on? What you thinking about? What is it that we don't know you saying out of your mouth, but yet we can't pick it? It's something about you. You ever been around people? You done been in their house? You done been on a job, and you just, everything about them is just so pure and so holy. But it's something about them, you just can't put your finger on it. Morally unclean. I just don't know what it is. God gonna reveal it to me, and then before you know it, you're having these nightmares and stuff about them. God's showing you. He's revealing things to you concerning the person.
And when he revealed it to you, it's not for you to go gossip. It's to pray, to tap into intercession, prophetic intercession. When prophetic intercession, when you're seeing things like that, meaning praying the heart of God. You got to pray what God see, not what you see. You got to pray what God see. Okay? Lasciviousness. Inclined to lust. You ain't having sex outside of marriage, or you are married and you just only with your spouse. However, you also like pornography. You like porn. You like Playboy magazines. You got a fine fly wife, but sometimes, you know, you staring at Nia Long. You looking at Venus and Serena a little too long. Every time they hit that ball, you trying to look up somebody's skirt. Oh, but you ain't cheating on your husband or your wife now. You know, you see Morris Chestnut and you just y'all melt. Y'all see Denzel Washington with his big T self and y'all just be, oh, he's so fine. And there's nothing wrong with saying that somebody's handsome, somebody's attractive, or anything like that. There's no, absolutely nothing wrong with that. Apostle, don't you get her? I hate my husband sometimes. Oh, my God. Because you be all up on Tina, boy. You be talking about her legs, Apostle Bowman. That's a joke. That's a joke. I know. I love you, too. But being inclined to lust. When your eyes wandering, you got wandering eyes. You ain't cheating. Oh, baby, you can't pay nobody. Can't nobody pay you to leave outside your house. But you sure looking. And those thoughts are going on in your head. It's not, like I said, there's nothing wrong with saying, oh, they're attractive. Oh, they're very handsome. Oh, she's very pretty. There's nothing wrong with that. And you can compliment another woman being a woman and say she is a beautiful girl. You ain't got to put no homo. We know you ain't gay. But the problem comes in if I say, yeah, Morris Chestnut, he's a handsome guy. Those big old lips and this and that. And man, his hair curls the right curl pattern. And man, I just wonder. And then before you know it, your imagination just start running away with you. Lasciviousness. Because why? You've lost self-control. For everything that you see under the works of the flesh, there is an attribute to the fruit of the Spirit that should be able to not just tame of whatever we are struggling with the lust of the flesh. There is an attribute to the fruit of the Spirit that should be able to mortify the deeds of the flesh. So what do you use to come against lasciviousness? Self-control. You get it? Oh, my God. Wow. I just saw that comment. The next one, idolatry. I like this one. The worship of idols or person or thing that is greatly admired. We love T.D. Jakes. Baby, T.D. Jakes didn't say, well, it ain't God. When we know we have so many prophets. That are viewing, probably viewing me right now. Some of you are prophets and apostles. You are anointed by God. You have been living the life of holiness. You have been doing everything you can to be saved. But nobody will call you because you are not their favorite speaker. Church idols. Because you're not Juanita Bynum. Because you're not, you know, a certain known name in your city. And it's not the person's fault. It's not the known person in that city's fault. It's not T.D. Jakes' fault. It's not Juanita Bynum's fault. It's none of their fault. But the idolatry falls on the person who idolized them and make them a god. This is why when people compliment us, we say, to God be